Dear students, welcome to Tungal online classes. Today, so we are going to start with a new chapter, that is chapter number 6, that is anatomy of flowering plants. So what do you mean by this anatomy? The question arises here. So anatomy is a branch of biology which deals with the study of internal structures, is called as anatomy, right? What is anatomy? It is branch of biology which deals with the study of internal structures, right, or the aspects called as anatomy. So this is more important branch of biology which convinces us the internal structures of both animals as well as plants. But here in this chapter we are focusing on plants itself, the internal structures of the plant. So the plant, so body is organized basically with the help of the basic unit, that is cells. Cells together form tissues, tissues together form organs, organs together form organ system. That way the organization of the body of both animals as well as plants has take place. So in this way, so here in this chapter mainly we are concentrating over the tissues especially. So first of all I go through the synopsis of this chapter and later we'll start with the one particular topic, right? So now the synopsis of this chapter. So what is anatomy, right? So is the major aspect. And after this one, who started the study of anatomy? So is major aspect. One more aspect what we are studying now. So and after this one, so histology in the sense that it is the branch of biology which deals with the study of histos or the tissues. So here the meaning of this word itself says histos means tissues, logy means study of tissues. It is nothing but study of all plant tissues we are focusing on. So here all the plant tissues that you have already studied in the bridge course as well as so in the previous classes, okay? So what are those plant tissues that you have studied? So see here, plant tissues are basically classified into two groups. So first one is meristem. Meristem is the first one and second one is permanent tissue, right? So like this, basically they are broadly classified this way. Meristematic tissues are of different types based on the origin, based on the function, so based on position itself, right? So there are 9 types of meristems that we study over here on 3 bases: based on position of this tissue, based on the origin of this tissue, based on the function of this tissue. So there are 9 types are there. So there are 9 types of meristematic tissues are there. Permanent tissues, so they have been classified. So what is the major basis of this classification is some cells in the plant body are always in state of continuous division and those cells are responsible for the growth of the plant body and such kind of tissue. So in which the cells are always in state of continuous division are said to be as meristematic tissue. And some of the cells are there, they are organized to form one tissue and those cells do not undergo any division and they become permanent, and that kind of tissues are known as permanent tissues. So this way there are basically two types of tissues that we come across. One is meristematic tissue and another one is permanent tissue, based on whether the cells are undergrowing, so undergoing division or not, right? So based on this, so permanent tissues, once again, they have been classified into, first one is simple permanent tissues. Simple permanent tissues and complex permanent tissues. Simple permanent tissues, once again, classified into three types. What are those three types of simple permanent tissues? I shall write here simple permanent tissues. Right? So these have been classified into three types. One is parenchyma, second one is parenchyma, and third one is sclerenchyma. So these are the three types of tissues that we come across. So next one is complex permanent tissues. Permanent tissues. So these are also classified into two types. So one is xylem and second one is phloem. So these are the tissues that we study thoroughly in this chapter. So already we came to know plant tissues, that is, study of tissues is nothing but histology. We study thoroughly the histology first, and later we study the tissue systems, very important aspect. So what are those one? Tissue systems. What are the tissue systems that we study over here? So there are three tissue systems that we come across over here, and they are, first one is epidermal tissue system is the first one, and ground tissue system is the second one, and vascular tissue system is the third one. So this way there are three types of tissue systems that we come across. One is epidermal tissue system, ground tissue system, as well as vascular tissue system. This way there are three kinds of tissue systems that we come across. So totally we study what is anatomy. So who started the study of anatomy? What is histology? So what are the plant tissues? What are the types of plant tissues? And ultimately, so tissue systems like epidermal, ground tissue system, as well as vascular tissue systems, that we study in this chapter thoroughly. And after that one, so next important aspect is, next important topic is anatomy of both monocots and dicot plants, right? Anatomy of both monocots and dicot plants. So in anatomy, what we study, when we take the meaning of this anatomy, it means dissect, means whenever we take the cross section or the longitudinal section of the plant body, how it looks like. So that is nothing but anatomy, what we are studying now. So in the anatomy of both the dicots and monocots, we study here mainly the roots of both the dicot as well as monocot, and stem as well as leaves. So these structures mainly we study over here. So here roots of both monocots as well as dicots, stem of both monocot as well as dicot, leaf of both monocot as well as dicot. So the anatomy of these things that we study thoroughly in this chapter, right? And after this one, the last and the ultimate thing, so what it is secondary growth in dicot plants as well as, so in dicot plants dicot plants. Especially, so here in secondary growth, we are, secondary growth means what the question arises. What do you mean by secondary growth? It is nothing but the widening of the plant body that increases, or the girth of the plant body that increases. So that kind of growth is called as the secondary growth. So what do you mean by primary growth? The question arises. Primary growth is nothing but the longitudinal growth of the plant body. So in lengthwise, if the plant grows, then that kind of growth is called as primary growth. In widthwise, so or widening of the plant body that increases is called as secondary growth. So this way, there are two types of growth that we come across. Meristematic tissue is responsible for both of these type of growth that you have studied in the previous classes. So secondary growth that we study, especially dicot plants, right? Secondary growth is seen in case of the dicot stem as well as roots. So that we study thoroughly in this chapter. These are the synopsis of this chapter, right? What I have explained till now. So what are the things that we study? Anatomy, study of anatomy, and next one, histology, all plant tissues, all types of plant tissues that we study thoroughly. And after that one, so we study, so what? The tissue systems that we study, epidermal tissue system, ground tissue system, as well as the vascular tissue system. After this one, anatomy of monocot as well as dicot plants. In those plants especially, we focus on root system as well as leaf. The internal structure of all these things that we study thoroughly. And so next one is secondary growth in dicot plants, especially in a dicot stem as well as root we study in this chapter. Now we shall start with a very important aspect. What is that? Anatomy of monocot and dicot plants, right? So let us start now in this session. Now we shall start with a study of the anatomy of dicot root, right? Anatomy of dicot root. So example that is taken in NCERT book is Helianthus annuus. Helianthus annuus is the example taken over here. Helianthus annuus is the scientific name of sunflower. Sunflower root is taken as dicot root. An example over here. So how is the structure of this dicot root? Is the major aspect what we learn now, right? So what it consisting of? Let us see here. We'll take the dicot root. This is the epidermis. Epidermis is followed by the parenchymatous tissue. Here, after this parenchymatous tissue, there we come across yes, this is the structure of dicot root, right? So how the internal structure of this dicot root is, so let us explain one by one. So it may be consisting of the outermost single celled layer. So it is called as what? Epidermis. and these epidermal cells sometimes, so they are rectangular in shape, sometimes they make one modification, means they extend or they protrude as a hair like projection, and such kind of hair like projections are called as root hairs. Means whenever you take the section of one root, say for example this is the plant body, so it has the shoot system and it has the root system here. Okay, so this is the root system. Whenever you take the cross section of this root, so that moment you will find this kind of structure, and this outermost layer itself is called as epidermis, and followed by the cortex, and followed by this is endodermis. This is the epidermis, this is endodermis, and within the endodermis this kind of structure, that is vascular bundles that you find in this structure itself, right? And let us study so how these parts are and what are these parts of this dicot root. So the outermost layer itself is called as epidermis. What it is? Epidermis. What is epidermis? It is also known as epiblema in roots, right? So this is also known as epiblema, or it is also called as piliferous layer. It is also known as, so it is also known as epiblema, epidermis. What is epidermis? It is an outermost, it is an outermost single-celled layer which is made up of rectangular cells which are attached each other without intercellular space, right? So you can observe here the cells do not have any intercellular space in green. These two cells, that kind of rectangular single celled layer, so which forms the outermost layer, and that outermost layer itself is called as what? Epidermis. What is known as epidermis. And this is made up of rectangular shaped cells which are attached side by side without intercellular spaces, right? So this is called as epidermis. And some of the epidermal cells, they modify into hair like projections, and they are called as root hairs. Note down that point too, right? Some of the epidermal cells modify into hair like projections called what? Epidermal hairs or root hairs. Or these are root hairs, they are called as. So these root hairs are unicellular one, right? Usually, right? And one more thing, so usually in plants, in case of a stem or any other parts, in the aerial parts where we come across a cuticle on the outermost single celled layer, that is epidermis. And that cuticle, in case of roots, it is totally absent. So cuticle is nothing but here we come across a thick wall, right? So thick layer itself, and that thick layer is absent in this case, hence it is so not having a cuticle. It does not have cuticle, right? It's a waxy coating on the outermost single celled layer, that is epidermis. It is always seen in case of stem or leaf or some other parts, right? So like this cuticle is absent. The point we noted, it is a neat point. So why? Because where actually so the cuticle is present, you must know, right? So okay, so epidermis over. And next one,
after this epidermis, you are observing here a large homogeneous,
means it is consisting of same type of cells, so same tissue it is made up of, hence it is said to be as a homogeneous tissue.
And this homogeneous tissue is called as cortex. Epidermis is followed by
the cortex,
and the cortex is made up of parenchymatous tissue.
Cortex is made up of parenchymatous tissue. How do you say it is parenchymatous tissue? Only one indication is very clearly saying us. So there are some large intercellular spaces are there. So ICS in the sense that intercellular spaces are present in between the cells.
And so because of that purpose, this is made up of what?
So parenchyma tissue. We can say it is made up of parenchymatous tissue. Right?
So this is cortex.
So note down that point too. What is that? Cortex. Right? So epidermis is followed by cortex, which is made up of parenchyma tissue, so with large intercellular spaces
are present over here.
Okay, and so this cortex
so is usually followed by, means
so the innermost
layer of the cortex itself is called as what? Endodermis. So this cortex, sometimes it makes the innermost single celled layer,
and that single celled layer is made up of barrel shaped cells, right? And that barrel shaped cell, single celled layer, so is called as endodermis. What it is known as? Endodermis. Point to be noted over here. Yes, endodermis. What is endodermis? It is an innermost single celled layer made up of barrel shaped cells, so which are attached side to side
without intercellular spaces. Here also they have been attaching,
so side to side without intercellular spaces. Of course, this is called as what? Endodermis. And one peculiar characteristic feature is seen in case of this endodermis. What is that characteristic feature?
See here, on the tangential walls as well as on the radial walls, so there we come across the thickening
over here, and that thickening is called as, so it is called as Cascadian thickening. What it is known as? Cascadian thickening. So all the cells have Cascadian thickening on both tangential as well as radial walls. On both tangential as well as radial walls, so it has thickening. So and that thickening is made up of a water repellent material. It does not so absorb the water, does not allow the water to enter in, and that kind of material which is made up of seborrheic. What it is made up of? Seborrheic. So let us see. So the endodermal cells are thickened with by what? Seborrheic.
material, severing material which is water repellent, or it is also said to be as it does not allow the water, right? So that kind of severing material that forms Castalian thickening. What it forms? Castalian thickening. This point is very important for me. Castalian thickening itself, right? So very important. And this Castalian thickening is made up of what? Severin, right? Severin. So cutin, you know, cuticle it means. So severin is there, right? The cell wall materials, you know, so cellulose, pectin, so severin, all these are the materials. But in case of these endodermal cells, where the thickening is called as Castalian thickening, and that Castalian thickening is made up of a severin material. So it is present on both tangential walls as well as radial walls also on these cells, except one cell. Very important point to be noted over here. Except one cell in the endodermis. So all the cells are uncovered with Castalian thickening. What is that cell, you may ask? So the cell which is lying opposite to the protoxylem, what is this xylem called as? This is xylem vessel itself. This is xylem vessel, this is xylem, this is xylem, xylem. So all these are the xylem vessels, right? So in the first xylem, this is called as protoxylem. What it is known as? Protoxylem. This is protoxylem. The cell of the endodermis opposite to the protoxylem do not have any Castalian thickening. Hence, this cell is known as passage cell. What it is known as? Passage cell. The cell which is lying opposite to protoxylem. The cell of the endodermis lying opposite to protoxylem is not having any Castalian thickening, and that cell is called as what? Passage cell. What it is known as? Passage cell. Okay, so the important point to be noted in case of endodermis, the cell of endodermis lying opposite to the protoxylem not having Castalian thickening, and that cell is called as passage cell. What it is known as? Passage cell. And this is very important for NEET examination, right? And so you know the water which is present around the, so these unicellular hair like projections called as root hairs. So this water is absorbed by the root hairs, and that comes to the epidermal cell. From the epidermal cell it comes to all these cortical cells, and from these all these cortical cells it comes to the passage cell. So since it does not have any Castalian thickening, through this cell only the water enters into the protoxylem. See here, the water enters from the root hair, so root hair to epidermal cell to all these cortical cells, and from all these cortical cells it reaches calcium. So passage cell to xylem tissue. So and all other cells except this passage cell do not allow the water to enter in, right? So the point to be noted, only the passage cell allows the water to enter into the xylem tissue, not at all other endodermal cells, right? So this point to be noted over here, right? Very important point. So for NEET point of view, okay? So next one.
Next one. Now we came to know what is endodermis and how the structure of this endodermis is and what is the peculiar characteristic feature of endodermis. It is followed by single celled layer once again. And this single celled layer, which is made up of parenchyma cells, and those parenchyma cells have thick cell wall, right? So this single celled thick walled parenchyma tissue, and that parenchyma tissue makes a single cell layer, and that layer is called as pericytal. What it is known as? Pericycle means endodermis is followed by single celled layer called as pericycle. What is that? Pericycle. It is thick walled single celled layer. So there is very peculiar characteristic feature of this layer is that. What is that? So you may ask. So this pericycle, so which initiates the formation of the lateral roots, right? So already I have drawn the diagram here. So think that these are the roots. These are the roots. See here, this is the primary root and these are the lateral roots. These origin of these lateral roots take place from the pericycle, point we noted, right? So lateral roots arise from pericycle. Point is very important, right, for meat. And one more thing is it initiates the origin of the vascular cambium also. Vascular cambium. So this vascular cambium is one type of meristem, which is responsible for the secondary growth in a dicot stem, right? So it is the meristem which is responsible for secondary growth in a dicot stem. Point to be noted. It is very important point. So for neat itself, right? Neat point this is also. So this is about the pericycle. See here, this pericycle is followed by the vascular bundles. Very important point to be noted over here. Yes, vascular bundles. Vascular bundles. What kind of vascular bundles are seen over here is very important point for me. So see here, this is protoxylem, this is metaxylem. Okay, so this is metaxylem, this is protoxylem. Metaxylem, protoxylem. These are all xylem tissues. How many xylems are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. So in NCERT has mentioned 2 to 4 number of xylem tissues are seen in this dicot root, right? So point to be noted. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 xylem are there. Phloem. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 phloem are here. So totally 4 number of xylem, 4 number of phloem are arranged. So alternatively, see here. So this is xylem. Next one is phloem, xylem, phloem, xylem, phloem, like this. Alternatively, they have been arranged over here. So then this kind of arrangement of the xylem as well as phloem, which are arranged over here. So this kind of vascular bundles is called as radial vascular bundle. What it is called as? Radial vascular bundle. Radial vascular bundles, right? Radial vascular bundle. Vascular bundle means what? So here xylem and phloem together form a bundle called as vascular bundle. Remember the point we remember. So basically vascular bundles consisting of both the tissues, but here in this case they are arranged alternatively. That is the difference over here. This kind of arrangement is called as radial arrangement or radial vascular bundles. These are called as. So now one point is clear.
And the arrangement of this xylem tissue is also considered over here. So xylem, that is metaxylem, is towards the center and protoxylem is towards the periphery. So it is towards the periphery and this is towards the center.
This kind of arrangement is called as centripetal arrangement of vascular organelles, that is centripetal arrangement of xylem tissue.
Right, metaxylem is towards the center and protoxylem is towards the periphery.
This is known as exarch. What it is known as? Exarch. The arrangement of the xylem itself is called as exarch. Exarch.
Exarch in the sense that protoxylem is towards periphery. And metaxylem is towards center. This kind of arrangement is said to be as exarch,
right? So this is also very important for NEET examination. One more point is.
So what is that? So here four number of xylem are here, four number of phloem are here.
The condition is said to be as tetrarch.
Then totally tetrarch. Then totally the type of vascular bundles in the dicot root.
They will ask in the examination as
the type of vascular bundles in dicot root. In dicot root, the type of vascular bundle is radial, tetrarch and exarch. So this is the type of vascular bundle present in dicot root. The point be noted here. What is that? Radial, tetrarch and exarch condition.
So this kind of the tissue is seen over here. Very important point.
And one more point. See here is a parenchymatous tissue, here, in between phloem as well as xylem there is a parenchymatous tissue is arranged over here, and that parenchyma is called as conjunctive tissue. What is conjunctive tissue?
It is the parenchymatous tissue which lies
between xylem as well as phloem,
and that tissue is called as parenchymatous tissue is called as conjunctive tissue. What it is known as? Conjunctive tissue. Point to be noted.
Very important point for once again NEET students.
So, see here.
So this conjunctive tissue is present or lying between xylem and phloem. And whenever you consider at the center or central axis of this root, there you find very narrow, inconspicuous, not so important, very narrow. So what is seen? Parenchymatous tissue is seen at the central axis, and this parenchymatous tissue is called as pith. What it is known as? Pith. Right? Very important point. After the vascular bundle, pith is explained over here. It is narrow and inconspicuous. Narrow, inconspicuous parenchyma present at the central axis. Present at the central axis forms the pith.
So pith sometimes is a storage tissue. What it forms? It forms the storage tissue. It helps in storage of the food material. In roots, usually storage of food material that take place. Especially
it take place inside the pith.
Right? So this is the point to be noted. Okay?
So this is only about this entire
dicot root itself. One more point is given in NCERT. What is that?
Very important point here. Except this endoderm.
The tissues which are lying inside the endoderm,
what are the tissues? Pericycle is there, vascular bundles are there, as well as pith portion is there. Especially, So here pericycle vascular bundles together form what? It forms steel. What it forms? Steel. Steel. This region itself is called as the stellar region. What it is known as? Stellar region. So this steel is made up of pericycle and vascular bundles. So together form what? Or big portion also. So together form what? It is called as stellar region. Okay, so this is all about the dicot route. It is usually asked in the annual theory examination for 5 marks. Okay, so all these 6-1 means dicot route is finished. So next we shall go to the monocot route. So that is also very important one. So it is similar to this dicot route itself. Let us study the monocot route now. So this is monocot route. Monocot route. So whenever we see the anatomy of monocot root, there also the similar structures what we have studied in dicots, so they we come across here. So one is outermost single celled layer is called as epidermis, followed by the cortex and endodermis, and the next one is pericycle here, right? So and next one is vascular bundles as well as pith portion or the central axis, like this. So similar structures that we come across, but what is the actual difference between monocots as well as the dicots, we'll go through by the study of the anatomy of this monocot root now. So the outermost layer, single celled layer, is epidermis itself. Epidermis. What is epidermis? I have already explained. It is an outermost single celled layer which is made up of rectangular shaped cells attached side by side without intercellular spaces, right? And some of the epidermal cells are modified into hair like projections, and those hair like projections are known as root hair. Then what is the point to be noted here? So what is epidermis? Definition we'll have to write here, and after this one, so next point is noted over here, that is root hairs you have to mention. And one more point I had mentioned, that is in case of root, cuticle is absent. The point to be noted over here, cuticle is absent. Thick waxy coating on the epidermal cell is called as cuticle, and that is made up of cutin, a waxy material that is totally absent in case of root. Since they are underground, there is no need of avoiding or to check the transpiration, means loss of water doesn't take place from the outermost layer of the part of the plant body. So in case of root, that is why there is no need of any cuticle in roots, right? So this is epidermis. Epidermis is also known as epiblema or piliferous layer, that you know it better, right? So this is about the epidermis. So which is followed by the cortex. So it is a homogeneous tissue which is made up of parenchymatous tissue, which is made up of cortex is made up of parenchyma. It is made up of parenchymatous tissue, and all the cells are similar in their structure, and there are many number of ICS are seen. What are ICS? Intercellular spaces are seen over here, and this is what? It is the cortex part, right? Very important one. Next point is endodermis. Actually, I should explain under this cortex the endodermis system. Why? Because it is an innermost single celled layer. It is an innermost single celled layer made up of barrel shaped cells,
which are attached side by side without interstellar spaces. Once again, the same Casparian thickenings are seen over here. What is that? Casparian thickenings are seen over here also. The radial walls as well as tangential walls are uncovered with different materials in this case, point to be noted, right? So here in this endodermal cells, in endodermal cells, the tangential walls are uncovered with one material, right? So and radial walls are uncovered with one more material. Radial walls are uncovered with, so here severin, and so tangential walls are uncovered with, so lignin material, right? So the point to be noted, lignin material as well as severin material, both uncovers the walls of these endodermal cells, the walls of these endodermal cells, and except one cell. What is that one cell doesn't have? So this thickening, the cell which is lying opposite to protoxylem, and this cell is called as passage cell. Passage cell. So it doesn't have any Casparian thickening, that's why easily the water that enters through this passage cell. So here the water absorption takes place by the root hairs, and it comes to the epidermis, next cortex, and next it comes to the cell opposite to protoxylem, and this cell is called as what? A passage cell. And through this passage cell the water enters into protoxylem itself. This is how the entry of water that take place through this endodermis, so through this passage cell only. Okay, now I hope you are so much clear about how the absorption of water is taking place over here. Imagine yourself, imagine all these aspects, right? So this root section, whatever I have taken, so here is, it is totally round in shape. Imagine yourself, it is the cross section of the root. So if it is root, this is the root, so we have taken the cross section of this root, and it looks how it looks, round in shape. The outermost layer has many of the hair like projections, and that hair like projections are called as root hairs, and followed by cortex. Cortex and innermost layer of the cortex is called as endodermis. Endodermis, inside the endodermis, what are arranged over here? Vascular bundles are arranged over here. So this is phloem, this is xylem, xylem. This is phloem, xylem, xylem. Means phloem, xylem, phloem, xylem, phloem, xylem. Like this alternatively, they have been arranged over here. Is it very clear? I hope it is very clear to you now. Okay, so let us see. Endodermis, Casparian thickening you came to know, and the passage cell also you came to know, passage cell. Okay, after this endodermis, what is the next layer? Pericycle. So it is a single celled layer present below the, present inner to the endodermis. Okay, so from which the lateral branches that arise in case of monocots. So see here, pericycle is also present over here, right? Pericycle is also present over here. And after this pericycle, we'll go to the vascular bundle. Very important point, that is vascular bundles which are seen in case of monocot root, right? Vascular bundles. What kind of vascular bundles are here? So once again you observe the arrangement of these xylem as well as phloem. So xylem makes the alternative tissue of the phloem. Alternatively, both are arranged over here. This kind of arrangement is called as radial arrangement. So hence the vascular bundle is said to be as radial, right? And once again, how many number of xylem are here? How many number of phloem are here? You can observe here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So like this, so many number of xylem vessels are there, and alternative to that one, phloem are also there. So that's why, so it is said to be as polyarch. Poly means many, polyarch condition, radial polyarch. And the arrangement of xylem tissue, protoxylem is towards the periphery, metaxylem is towards the center. Then this kind of arrangement is called as exarch. Exarch. Then the type of vascular bundles present in monocot root are radial, polyarch and exarch. Very important point to be noted over here. So this is very important for Nate. Okay, so this kind of vascular bundles are seen over here. This is about the vascular bundle. What is that? Vascular bundle. And what is the difference between the pith portion of this monocot as well as pith portion of that dicot root? So there is a lot of difference. What is the difference? So there it was very small and inconspicuous word I had used for describing the so pith portion of dicot root. But here the pith portion is very large enough. The pith is very large enough. Neat point it is. So pith portion is very large in case of a monocot root, but it is very small and inconspicuous in case of dicot root. Point to be noted. Neat point it is. The question are arised already, so you point this point to be noted. And one more thing here, in case of monocots, there is no secondary growth is seen over here. Secondary growth in case of monocots is absent. Point to be noted, very important point to be noted here. So this is all about what? This monocot root. So this is about the anatomy of dicot root as well as monocot root. By this we finished the root itself. And the next one, so is stem. We shall start with the stem in the next video. Thank you.